Good morning, and welcome to City Watch for Saturday, June 16th, 2018. City Watch is a watchdog program where we invite guests to share their perspectives on social, economic, political, and cultural issues here in New York City. Hosting today are Joel Berg and Jeff Simmons. Good morning to you both.
Good morning, and happy Bloomsday, the day that James Joyce's Ulysses took place on.
Well, yeah, well, that's for sure. You've planned for some terrific guests for today's show. First up will be Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz, Jr., who'll discuss the mayor's proposal regarding admissions to the city's specialized schools, this week's NYCHA controversy, and much more. Our next guest will be Ann Toback, Executive Director of the Workmen Circle. And rounding out today's lineup will be one of the outstanding civil servants who won one of the Fund for the City of New York Sloan Public Service Award, Sandy Bryant-Townsend of City's Human Resources Administration. She'll be with us as well.
Good morning, Joel. It's great to be able to co-host with you.
It's great to be here, and I'm following Sean's strict admonition that I will speak directly into the microphone. Sometimes I get exercised. I forget that radio, you can't see facial expressions and gesticulation, so I'm learning to be this radio host thing, sort of.
How has your week been going?
Considering the world is falling apart piece by piece, bit by bit, it's been going pretty well. I went to a protest the other night against the separations, family separation policy. It was a good turnout in Brooklyn, even though it was planned on about a day's notice. But other than that, It's nice weather, even though the country's going down the tubes, but we can fight back. How was your week?
In fact, that's one of the things that's been on my mind walking on Atlantic Avenue this morning has been how wonderful this weather is today, because we've had a rough few weeks. I went to a concert in Central Park Summer Stage this week, and at every moment, it seemed like the skies were going to open up and it was just going to pour. So I am incredibly appreciative of the wonderful weather today.
And you know what? Every morning there's going to be a sunrise. Although I'm some days reminded, speaking of Irish writers, of Sam Beckett, who has once said, the depressed playwright, "Beautiful day, Sam, makes you happy to be alive." He goes, "I wouldn't go that far." So we ready for our first guest?
Yes, we are. Our first guest today is Ruben Diaz, Jr., who is now in his third and final terms as Bronx Borough President. During his tenure, the Borough President has focused on economic development, housing, health, education, and public safety issues, and helped to bring significant new projects to the borough. He previously served 7 terms in the state legislature as a member of the assembly, and he's also expected to make a run for City Hall when Mayor de Blasio's second term ends. Welcome to the show, Borough President Diaz.
Good morning. Thank you for having me on. Good morning, Joe. Good morning, Jeff.
Good morning.
Good morning, Borough President Diaz. This is Jeff, and welcome to the show. For our listeners who don't yet know what a borough president does, can you just briefly explain your role and where does the power lie versus what a mayor and our state representatives do?
Well, for those who don't know what a borough president does, in the city of New York, obviously we have 5 boroughs. Every one of the boroughs has a president. And the city charter gives us a number of different authorities, everything from dealing with land use issues through the public review process. We appoint every single community board member in our boroughs. We deal with economic development, which focuses on borough-wide issues. And we appoint people to influential and significant boards like the PEP, which is the education panel of the city of New York. We appoint people to the retirement pension system. We work there with the comptroller's office, as well as the franchise and concession board and the industrial development agency, the IDA, among other things, as well as using our relationships in our bully pulpit to do the best that we can for the people in our boroughs.
Now, you're in your final term. What would you say has been your top accomplishment?
Whoa, I mean, we've done so much. I think when you look at what we've been able to do with the schools, with our public schools, allocating tens of millions of dollars from to everything from auditoriums to science and computer labs, creating jobs, working with the State Department of Labor, and the Bronx Overall Economic Development Corporation. We've cut unemployment by more than half. We've been bringing in businesses. There's been 84 million square feet of economic development in the last 9 years. When you look at housing, we've seen over 40,000 units of housing, all kind of housing, from deep affordability to home ownership. But my biggest accomplishment, I would say, is just changing the mindset of what people think and view of the Bronx, and from both those individuals who don't live here as well as those who live inside the Bronx. Look, life isn't perfect here, but I think that we are moving the needle. We are moving in the right direction. And folks are starting to realize that we're no longer the Bronx of the 70s, the 80s, and the early 90s, in the rest of the world. They know that we are a new paradigm for economic progress and a renaissance. And then those people who live here, look, when we were beaten so badly, we were demoralized, our spirit was broken. And again, while life isn't perfect, I think that one of my greatest accomplishments is that the people of the Bronx are starting to ask for more. We know we deserve better. We know that our brighter days are ahead of us. So I think that that's my biggest accomplishment, is changing the psychology of the people who live here and the negative stereotypes and perceptions from those who don't.
Borough President, this is Joel. You've accomplished a lot, and you still have a few years left in your term. But is there anything that really sticks out in your mind as something you really wanted to accomplish but haven't yet accomplished? And if so, are you still working to get that done?
Well, yes, and this is what has me waking up every single day and keeps me up every single night. So it's the reason why I ran for re-election in my third term. Look, we still have to finish the pavilion at Orchard Beach. We started that campaign a couple of years ago. We've raised over $70 million, and we believe it could be a year-round destination. And we're moving forward, but I want to make sure that we finish that. We started the conversation to have 4 Metro North stations, which are now, thanks to Governor Cuomo, fully funded. We're going to have them in the Bronx. That's going to be transformative, not only for the Bronx, but for the city of New York, where we're going to create jobs, we're going to create density around 3 out of the 4 Metro North stations, but we can put people to work to and from Midtown in less than half an hour and going north into Connecticut. But we still have to push so that when the LIRR gets the East Side access, we get some of those spaces, those slots at Penn Station. We are working to restore and redo, reimagine, actually, the Bruckner-Sheridan interchange. That's $1.8 billion. We need to do the Kingsbridge National Ice Center. So there are a number of major projects, as well as continue to create jobs and better our educational system and afford more opportunities for Bronxites so that as the Bronx progresses, we bring along as many people as we can in that progression.
That, as you know, there are a lot of false stereotypes about poverty. It's a problem in every one of the 5 boroughs, a problem in every suburban, urban, and rural state in New York and in America. And the Bronx, as you know, there's been a significant reduction in poverty over the last few years because the unemployment rate has gone down and wages have edged up, particularly because of the governor of others support a minimum wage increase. That being said, as you know, Mr. Borough President, the Bronx still has the highest level of poverty out of any urban county in the United States. About 1 in 3 Bronx residents live in poverty, and about 1 in 2, about half the children in the Bronx still live in poverty. Why do you think there's been progress, but why do you think there's still such a high poverty rate, and who's responsible for fixing it? Is it the nation as a whole? Is it the state? Is it the city? Is it a borough? Is it a combination of all those things?
All of the above. I think we all have that responsibility. And like I said, stated earlier, life isn't perfect. But the reality is that for many decades, the Bronx has not received the resources of funding that we deserve. And while that is changing, we're seeing the city, the state, all of the elected officials working together. Non-for-profits are out there providing services to the poor. We can use more help from the federal government. But what we're also doing is that we are partnering with private industry. I mean, we started something called the PIC, the Private Industry Council, where it's a council with all of the major employers in the Bronx are coming together and hiring our youth. because while we've cut unemployment down in the Bronx, we still see between the ages of 18 through 24, the unemployment is up almost 24%. So we're hiring our youth, but not just with summer jobs, but also with the intention to create a farm system so that it was more like an apprenticeship program so that eventually they can obtain those jobs. So I think it's incumbent, and the responsibility falls on all of us, whether it's the local government, the city and state, and the federal government, to provide the resources to make sure that we educate our youth, to invite businesses and work with businesses who are responsible corporate neighbors, and then marry them the way that we've been doing with the State Department of Labor and the BOEDC, where every single day we work with individual constituents who are looking for work, and then based on their skill set, we marry them to the employers. So there are a number of things that we have to do here, and even though we're creating jobs, we still have to make sure that we keep up with the economy of the future, which is technology.
So, Borough President, this is Jeff, and it feels like in the last few weeks there has been much controversy over a proposal by Mayor de Blasio and Schools Chancellor Carranza to overhaul the admissions process to the city's specialized high schools like Stuyvesant and Bronx High School of Science. So while this may bring in more diversity, a number of advocates also charge it's pitting communities against each other and isn't a fair solution. Where do you stand on this?
Well, I don't think anybody can agree that having a system where 70%+ of the students, an educational system where 70%+ of the students are African, American, and Latino, but about 10% of them are in specialized high school. I don't think anybody can agree that that's working. With that said, I am concerned with the fact that communities are being put against each other, and that's exactly what we don't want. We need to continue this conversation. I'm happy that the mayor has joined this conversation. I've been working on this since 2012. We put out two different reports, and we've offered many different solutions. For your listeners, they should understand this. There are three specialized high schools that are codified by statute in the state legislature. That's Stuyvesant, Bronx Science, Stuyvesant, Bronx, and Brooklyn Tech. But there are an additional five that were created by the Department of Education. So what I'm saying is, look, we don't have to fight over the current amount of seats. We can increase the amount of seats. We can do testing plus. Everyone knows that Ivy League universities, Yale, Harvard, they don't make their decisions on admissions solely based on testing. So we should add portfolios. We should add GPA. It should matter that if a student has a perfect GPA, but perhaps did not test so well on that one giving day, we should take that into consideration. Recommendation letters, interviews, and I think that would open up more opportunities so that all of the children in the city of New York can excel academically. I know that the proposal that the mayor put out there was done late in the legislative session. The Speaker of the Assembly has punted it for the next session, and I agree with that. And I think now it's time for all of us to have the conversation, every single community, all of the stakeholders, and come up with a sound solution and or solutions so that we can rectify what has otherwise been a system that has not been totally inclusive.
Another controversy that you know has been in the news has been the horrible treatment of New York Public Housing Authority residents, NYCHA Authority residents. The federal government issued a scathing report. The city entered a consent decree with the federal government. And it was clear that the mismanagement has gone on a long time, starting under Mayor Bloomberg and probably before that, and under Mayor de Blasio. How much the blame do you think should be on the mayor's and the housing authorities versus how much blame do you think should be placed on the federal government for slashing funding to public housing? And more importantly, what should be done now?
Well, that's a loaded question. I mean, while the problems facing
I'm full of them. Certainly
well, they predate the current administration. This administration has played a role in the ongoing crisis, and there's no denying that. We know that They failed to provide the proper lead inspection, the mold abatement, and heat to tenants. They've lied to the city council. They lied on applications to the federal government. We've seen cases, for instance, where they lied about knocking on tenants' doors when they never did so. They lied with regards to visitation on with the exterminators. They lied about using pesticides and only use water. And so this administration, I believe, has to be held accountable for perpetuating the failure, perpetuating the deception, for perpetuating the lies, even if the governmental malpractice has been occurring prior to them. And so we have to hold them accountable. And by the way, any single person who knowingly and willingly broke the law, endangering the lives of NYCHA residents, must be held accountable. We have children who have been exposed to lead because inspections weren't done and because the city lied to these families. That's long-term mental health effects that happen to these children. Who's going to be held responsible for that? We need to have these answers. And then this admission, it's a good thing and a bad thing. This consent decree, which is an admission, it's a good and a bad thing in that at least the New York City Housing Authority is going to have a baseline budget of hundreds of millions of dollars over the next decade or so. And I believe that's a good thing. And the state and the federal government should do their share as well, because the help is needed. But at the same time, it really concerns me and so many others that, A, the tenant leaders are not included in the monitoring, and B, that monitoring is at the hands of this federal government. I mean, do we really believe that Donald Trump and Secretary Carlson have the best interests of NYCHA and its tenants at heart? I don't think so. It remains to be seen. It's a travesty what's happening to the men and women, the over 400,000 men and women and children who live in the New York City Housing Authority. They deserve better. And I'm going to continue, as I've done for many years, to fight for them and to make sure that they live in dignity.
Well, if the HUD secretary put as much attention into fixing public housing as he did to getting a luxury conference room table for himself, we'd be all set. Jeff?
There's an old saying, right, that it doesn't take a brain surgeon. But in this case, I don't know if the brain surgeon knows what he's doing.
So, Borough President, this is Jeff. Last week, you had participated in the Puerto Rican Day Parade, and you had said beforehand that you wanted the parade to serve as a protest march, and you noted the death toll in Puerto Rico of nearly 5,000 people as a result of Hurricane Maria last year, significantly higher than the official count of 64. Why the disparity, and tell me a little about the message you hope to convey during the parade.
Well, the parade was our 60th annual National Puerto Rican Day Parade, and it's a parade whose, I think, it's one, if not the largest parade in the country. It's by far the largest visibility day for Puerto Ricans. And while we go out there and we celebrate our culture and our heritage and our pride and who we are as Puerto Rican people and all of our contributions, as we should, I thought it was it should be different. That's the reason why I marched with a banner and T-shirts that had the number 4645, signifying the number of deaths up until December 31st, post-Hurricane Maria. These are numbers that were put out by a Harvard report. I believe that number is even higher now. And I also put out the three R's, because if we want respect, we need to remember, we need to register, we need to resist. We need to get political. And that's the message that we wanted to put out there. I thought it was a powerful march. Many Puerto Ricans did the same. Many contingencies did the same. They protested in the way they saw fit. And I think it's just the beginning of now of us sending a clear message to the Trump administration, who has shown the most egregious example of governmental neglect to 3.5 million Americans. And you know what? Our family members are dying. They need help. And this government has helped states like Texas, Florida. They help foreign countries that are not even our allies and our enemies, and they've totally turned their backs. and they need more better infrastructure. They need an electric grid. They need funding for to rebuild their houses. You know, they need to help. They need help with the economy, and we can no longer just celebrate and stand by and pretend like life is normal. So I thought that it was time for us to send that message.
And you also just recently visited the island with Governor Cuomo last month, and you have family members who live there. Can you tell us a little about what you saw and experienced?
So, yes, my father's from Bayamón, Puerto Rico, and my mother's from Ponce, and I still have aunts and cousins who I've been to the island now twice since the hurricane. Usually I visit the island two or three times a year. Let me just say this, that no one has done more to put a spotlight on Puerto Rico and help Puerto Rico than Governor Andrew Cuomo. And for that, the Puerto Rican community thanks him. What we saw a couple of weeks ago, when you fly over, you see blue tarps because people still don't have roofs. You see folks still standing, you know, online in certain stores. You hear from a lot of people who haven't been able to get back to work because the economy in many different industries is not where it's supposed to be. And we went out there to do an announcement with the men and women of unions and the trade unions, the organized labor, where they're training Bronxites, Puerto Ricans, on fixing the homes, cleaning up the homes. We work with the CUNY and the SUNY students and the CUNY system, where students are going over there volunteering, sanitizing homes. Many of these homes are still have encrusted mud, and people haven't been able to go back after so many months. So there's still a lot of work that needs to happen. And unfortunately, however, we're right on the cusp of the new hurricane season. So we still are, Puerto Rico is still at a place where it is not sustainable, where it's not resilient. They need the resources. So we're doing all that we can, but the federal government needs to do more by American citizens, and we're going to continue to put the spotlight on it.
Thank you, Mr. Borough President. We need to wrap up, but one last lightning round question. Are you running for mayor or public advocate? Are you willing to announce this morning on the City Watch show, a very appropriate venue?
So I'm term limited. This is my third and last term. I think that we've been working on all of the areas where people are living better, all of the pillars of hope and opportunity, education, economic development, job creation. And if I'm going to stay in government, if I'm going to run for office, the only office that I'm interested that I think that I can do even more for more New Yorkers is that of mayor of the city of New York.
Okay, well, thank you, Mr. Borough President. We'll all stay tuned.
Stay tuned. Thank you for the opportunity.
So what I found interesting also was just talking about some of the controversies of the day, like NYCHA and the specialized schools. It's important. It's going to keep on going.
Yes. The school controversy is particularly fraught because it's pitting, frankly, historically marginalized groups against each other, Asian Americans against African Americans and Latinos and Latinas. So we're ready for our next guest.
Yes, with us now is Ann Toback, Executive Director of the Workmen Circle, which is hosting a Jewish food festival tomorrow. The Workmen Circle is a century-old organization that powers progressive Jewish identity through Jewish cultural engagement, Yiddish language learning, multi-general education, and social justice activism. And it does this through contemporary cultural programs, holiday celebrations, social justice campaigns, Yiddish language classes, and interactive educational experiences. Anne, welcome back to City Watch.
Thank you. It's great to be back.
Hi, Anne. This is Joel. I know about Workman Circle. My mother was active with them. I had a sister went to a Workman Circle school in Rockland County. But for those listeners who aren't aware, could you tell us a little bit about what the organization's doing today and how it fits into contemporary New York?
Sure, I would love to. I would like to touch back to, and it's amazing your mom was part of us, as were, I guess, really hundreds of thousands of people in the last century. The Workman Circle was founded in 1900 by Eastern European immigrant activists. They came to America looking for safety, for security, for economic reasons, and they really came together as a fraternal benefit society, mutually supporting each other as they made the transition into the United States. They quickly found a country that wasn't particularly welcoming in many instances, gave them terrible jobs, challenged their right to be there, some things that we hear a lot of, you know, echoes of today. And they created a community that both supported their own transition but also worked together to make a better world for all. So they became very involved in the labor movement. And one of the outcomes of their working together was this network of schools, a network of camps, and you know, community support and a lot of activism. So today, we've really taken the values of our founders, a commitment to a better world for all, through an activist lens, and our organization, everything we do is really in support of creating that better world and the progressive Jewish identity. So we have the largest Yiddish language program in the world. We literally teach it worldwide through online programs as well as in-person programs here in New York. We have 7 supplementary schools that are in New York and Chicago, and we have 1 in Boston and 1 in New Jersey. We do Jewish cultural events like Tomorrow's, which I know we're going to talk about, Taste of Jewish Culture, Diversity is Delicious Celebration. And as we have from day one, the Workmen Circle is committed to training activists, young and old, and really thoughtfully and intentionally transforming the world. And today we're doing it really, again, connected to our roots through economic justice and immigrant rights.
Now, I know Jeff's in a little bit going to ask you more about the food festival, but I've just got to say, like many Jews, my favorite Jewish food is Chinese. That's a long Jewish tradition, particularly on December 25th, when you know, Chinese restaurants are often the only place open for Jews to eat. But let me just ask you to opine briefly on the similarity and differences between kreplach, Jewish dumplings, and Chinese dumplings.
You know, it's amazing, and dumplings are one of my favorite foods to talk about. I mean, food is really a gateway to culture, period, all of our cultures. And, you know, I know about both. I've had many of both, and of course, there's pierogi, too, which is a similar, a close cousin to kreplach. Kreplach seems to have, in my view, a thicker dough than most Chinese dumplings that I've had, but you know, it all sort of depends on what you put inside. And, of course, it's funny because there's it's poignant, let's say, because a number of Jews escaped from Eastern Europe in the 30s and 40s through Shanghai. And I know some people whose families went through Shanghai and then wound up in the United States. And I've been asking them, you know, have you taken any of the food cultural parts that when they stayed in Shanghai, and I haven't discovered this yet, but it's something I'm looking into.
You're listening to Ann Toback of the Workman Circle along with Joel Berg and Jeff Simmons on City Watch, WBAI New York, 99.5 FM, and streaming live at WBAI.org.
On a more serious note, my mother came to this country literally 2 months old with her parents from what was then Poland, is now in the Ukraine, and she, our whole family clearly would have been massacred had they not come here. I just can't imagine that what would have happened had she been separated from her parents. Now, just this week, the Workmen's Circle co-signed a letter along with 25 other Jewish organizations to Attorney General Sessions, criticizing the policy that separates children from their migrant parents when they cross the border. Can you talk about why that's so important and why you think that's particularly important for Jewish Americans?
Of course, and I do want to emphasize it should and must be important for all Americans, but from the Jewish experience, which is still very raw from the Holocaust, which, let's remember, was only 75 years ago happening, we know the life and death danger of closing our borders to refugees fleeing to our country, seeking safety, and the images of children being separated from their parents can't but remind us of some of the horrors that our people experienced 75 years ago in Eastern Europe when the Nazis overtook the countries. we know, you know, when it's so close to who we are, we can't help but remember the St. Louis, a ship holding over 900 Jews that sailed from Germany in May of 1939, and really in June, 79 years ago now, was seeking entry into the United States and was denied entry here and in other countries as well, and many of those, and was forced back to Germany, and many of the passengers were murdered. The images we're seeing echo what we saw in those days when borders were closed, when children were being forcibly removed to terrible ends from their families. And although we live in different times for sure, we can't stand by and see a terrible history being repeated in any form. And number one, we must not close our borders to people, many of whom are really running for their lives to the United States. We have refugees from Syria for whom our borders are closed, and many of the refugee families coming here from Central America who are being stopped, and the children really being ripped away from their parents are here for safety reasons. Some are for economic reasons because, you know, they really can't survive. But these are people coming here out of desperation and to punitively take their children in such a cruel and barbaric fashion. It goes against everything we as Jews believe in. It goes against our heritage of fighting for freedom, fighting for people to have the right to live and enjoy life. And of course, it's so reminiscent of very recent past for us.
So, for listeners, full disclosure, this is Jeff. I work with Anne in the Workmen's Circle on publicity. But Anne, you and I have talked about the contributions of immigrants over time. And
yes,
Tomorrow you have your Taste of Jewish Culture Street Festival taking place, which does have an immigrant theme. Can you tell us a little more about it?
Yes. So this is the fourth year of our Taste of Jewish Culture Festival, which really was designed to celebrate Jewish culture in every way, but absolutely through food, because food is, as I said, such a wonderful gateway to all cultures. But last year, as we saw so many in the immigrant communities under attack by our government, we thought, what a great opportunity to highlight the many contributions immigrants make to our society. And that's the, you know, right now we're so busy with some very disturbing issues, but let's not forget that our country is stronger for our diversity, and that's one of the terrible outcomes of the times we're living in, is that diversity is being suppressed, and the many cultures that have come together to make our country wonderful are sort of being pushed away, and it's terrible, and it's also something we can't forget, and we should encourage those to highlight those different cultures at every turn. So this food festival, we've made our tagline, "Diversity is Delicious," and we've sought out many different cultures from all over the world and said, why don't you come to our festival on 6th Avenue between 48th and 49th tomorrow and bring your cultural foods, and then can you do a mix-up between your foods and some Jewish foods? And we have about 30 vendors coming and doing just that.
Can you just give us a sense of the diversity, some of the vendors that are going to be there tomorrow? And I believe it starts at 11 o'clock?
Yes, it starts at 11 and it runs till 6. So some of my favorites is we have a group called Bonsai Kakigori. That's a Japanese shaved ice, really delicious. And they're doing shaved ice land of milk and honey. So that's their ode to the Jewish experience. We have La New Yorkina, which does Mexican paletas, popsicles, and they're doing babka ice cream sandwiches in addition to their popsicles. And we have a group, What's the Diaz, and they're doing Ruben quesadillas. We have, you know, we have Empanada Papa, and they're doing a take on empanadas. We're just, it's going to be a city block full of, you know, sweet and savory. Harlem Seafood Soul is doing a blackened salmon. Oh, and one of the craziest mashups that I'm looking forward to trying, there's a group called Nachos Libra, and they're doing a cream cheese and lox nachos, which we'll see. It could go right. It could go wrong.
Any kimchi bagels?
No kimchi bagels, but that's something to think about for next year. Oh, we have another one, Mystic Masala, which I like because they're doing a mashup of masala potato pancakes, masala latkes.
And it's not just about food tomorrow, but also I believe you have some type of performances.
We do. We have performances all day long, but we're very excited. At 1 o'clock, we're going to have a special performance by the National Yiddish Theater Volksbühne, who is doing a Yiddish Fiddler on the Roof performance this year. And they're going to be performing at 1. But all day long, we have Aaron Alexander and the New York Klezmer All-Stars, along with a dance leader, and they're going to be performing klezmer music all day long. And at 2 p.m. and 3 p.m., something actually I really think a lot of people are going to want to do, we have an interactive instant Yiddish class with the director of our Yiddish programs, Kolya Borodulin. And that's in literally 15 minutes, you're speaking some Yiddish, and it's something that shouldn't be missed. So that's at 2 p.m. and 3 p.m.
Speaking of which, Jeff told me you guys are teaching dogs to obey commands in Yiddish. That's Meshuggah. Is this true?
It's true, and it is Meshuggah, and it's an enormous amount of fun.
Can you give us some commands in Yiddish?
Yeah, so zit is sit, arop is down, arois is up, and my favorite, this is a new command we're premiering in 2 weeks, spring, which is just as it sounds, it's jump. We're adding a little bit of agility to our afternoon, our morning, late morning in Central Park with some jumps. So,
well, I can appreciate that. My Bubby and Zeta, my grandmother and grandfather, gave me some commands in Yiddish. And
was it ever spring?
No, but they did label me Wilde Gruß, wild grass, because they said I was everywhere at once. Well, thank you, Anne, so much for joining us. We encourage people to go out to the Yiddish the food festival tomorrow. What's the official name?
Taste
of Jewish Culture Street Festival. Diversity is delicious. If I could add a plug, go to circle.org, and you can also find out about Yiddish for Dogs, which we're holding July 1st.
There you go. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne.
Thank you.
So I don't know about you, but I'm hungry right now.
I'm food insecure, yes.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, our last guest is one of the winners of the Fund for the City of New York's 45th Annual Sloan Public Service Awards, which were presented earlier this month. Sandy Bryant-Townsend is the Executive Director of the Office of Legal Affairs, Fair Hearing Administration, within the New York City Human Resources Administration. The fund was established by the Ford Foundation 50 years ago, and throughout its history has developed and helped implement innovations in policy, programs, practices, and technology to advance the functioning of government and nonprofit organizations in New York City and beyond. Regarded as the Nobel Prize of city government, the awards are presented to civil servants from all levels, ranks of city government. Good morning, Sandy. Welcome to the show.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
Good morning, Sandy. This is Joel. And first of all, congratulations. Secondly, I just want to reinforce the importance of public service. I work for the federal government. I now work for a nonprofit group. And people sort of automatically assume if you work for the government, you're horrible. And if you work for a nonprofit group, you have a halo. When, in truth, the work I do is very similar to what I did in the government. And I think we all need to value public service more. And the truth is, city commissioners generally make far less than the people they regulate. So I just think we all need to recognize the importance of public service more. So with that, tell me, how did you find out you received this award, and what does it mean to you?
Well, I was notified by the president, Ms. Mary McCormick, that I won the award. It's really, really hard to describe what it means to me because it's beyond my wildest dreams. What I do because I love doing it. I never did anything in reference to my job for recognition. So it's really, really wonderful recognition.
Now, I heard our sources tell us, and this is not fake news, that you started out as a temp earning $3.25 an hour in 1989. Is that true?
Yes, that's true. When I started with, I was actually hired as a temporary employee through an agency, and I was fortunate enough to be placed in one of the HRA offices. And the minimum wage then was $3.25 an hour.
And just so our listeners know, or frankly, our listeners from low-income backgrounds almost all know what the Human Resources Administration is, or as we in the field say, HRA, many of the other listeners won't. Can you explain what it does? It's now part of the Department of Social Services, which has merged with the Department of Homeless Services. But can you tell just a little about what the agency overall does and what you do in your position as the Director of the Office of Legal Affairs, Fair Hearing Administration? That's a long title.
Well, you know, the agency serves our most vulnerable city participants, and we help at every level. What I do at the Fair Hearing Administration is we conduct fair hearings through the Office of Temporary Disability Assistance, where an applicant or participant can request a fair hearing to appeal one or more issues affecting the receipt of their benefits. The state holds the hearing, which is conducted by administrative law judge under the Office of Administrative Hearings. At the hearing, the applicant and or participant is referred to as an appellant, and they're able to also have non-legal representation to assist them at the hearing, and they have the opportunity to present evidence, establish facts and circumstances, or ask questions in reference to the decisions that we make.
So in other words, someone applies for public benefits, either cash assistance that used to be known as EFDC since 1996 is now known as TANF or cash assistance of the city, or for SNAP benefits, most people would know as food stamps benefits, and they're either turned down by the city or they get less than they thought they were entitled to. They are allowed to apply for a fair hearing, and the state oversees that in conjunction with the city, and that's part of your responsibility to deal with that. Is that a fair summary?
Correct.
Okay, great.
So, Sandy, it's Jeff. Welcome to the show. What I'd like to just mention is that the award recipients are nominated by their colleagues, their peers, friends, and selected from more than 250,000 eligible workers in mayoral agencies, the transit and housing authorities, and Health and Hospitals Corporation and CUNY, and the DA's offices. So these nominations come from your peers. And when the fund made its announcement, it said that you stood out for your ability to motivate others, had a deep compassion for clients, and you had an understanding of how to make the systems work better. Tell me a little about what motivates you. Where does this passion come from?
Well, the greatest feeling I have is when I help someone. Every day I'm asked to be able to motivate someone to be the best person they can be. I try to motivate people to understand that where they are is not where they have to remain, that they can contribute to the determination of their future.
So I also understand you've been promoted 9 times since you first started. Tell me a little about that experience.
Well, I began, like I said, at the most entry level, and I worked on every title up until the position that I'm in now, from a clerical assistant to an eligibility specialist determining eligibility. Working at every level helps me to identify with the staff at every level, and I'm able to share my experience with them, with the challenges that they may be experiencing in their current position. So that's very rewarding to me, and it just helps me to identify with the staff at every level.
Now, HRA's office is in the financial district area, and you're surrounded by all these banks. I believe you could probably be making 2 or 3 times what you're making now if you worked for a bank. Why have you chosen, such a talented, hardworking, effective person, to dedicate your career to public service? And we say bureaucrats, I say public servants. You're serving all of us. Why have you chosen to do that, probably at great sacrifice?
It warms my heart what I do. I believe that I'm living in my purpose, I don't believe that when I started working for HRA, I didn't understand the benefit that and the blessing that it was to be placed in HRA. I really believe that I'm working in the position that my higher power has designed for me. I love being a public servant, and I, at the end of the day, if I can help one person when I go home, I'm satisfied with my life.
I just say I run a nonprofit group in my day job fighting hunger, and we get a lot of credit. But the truth is the greatest anti-hunger agency in New York City by far is New York City HRA. You administer about $2.8 or $2.9 billion. That's billion with a billion, with a B, worth of food a year under the SNAP program, the food stamps program. That dwarfs what every charity can give out. Can you talk about what you think the importance of the role of government is in addressing social problems?
I think that based on what you just said, it has to be the greatest reward to be able to ensure that people eat every day. The fact that we're helping our most vulnerable New Yorkers is, it should be enough. If it's not enough, you know, we offer so many other services. It's just very rewarding at the end of the day for me.
Okay, now, obviously, city government or no government is Eden. What kind of challenges do you face on a daily basis and your peers, and how do you deal with that?
Well, when people walk into our doors, we understand that there's a need, and it can be challenging. Whenever I walk into an office, honestly start my day with the Serenity Prayer. Asking to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to make a difference in someone's life. I'm not afraid to ask for help. I know that I'm just an arm's length away, and in most situations, it's either how can I help you or can you help me?
So, Sandy, you just talked about, you know, accepting the things you cannot change, but what are some of the practices, for instance, that you've been able to put in place to help the your clients, and even some money-saving measures that might have been adopted as a result of your work?
Well, I participated in the introduction of Access HRA with the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, and it helps New Yorkers tremendously. With Access HRA, New Yorkers can apply for SNAP, recertify existing cases, and submit required documents digitally. They can manage their benefits, keep track of important dates as it pertains to their case. With these new tools, it gives our clients more freedom to interact with HRA in the way that works best for them. It helps our clients to ensure that they don't miss important deadlines and continue to receive the benefits that they qualify for.
So when you, by the way, when you learned that you got this award and told your family, what was their reaction? What did they say about this?
They were very proud. They were, it's really hard to describe the feeling that came with it. I'm still bursting with joy because I don't do my work for recognition. I really, really enjoy what I do. So to be recognized, there's hundreds of people that I work with that contribute to this city and do the same kind of work that I do, that love the population that we serve, that take value in the services that we offer to the public. So my family was very happy.
And I know that feeling well. I had worked in the New York City Comptroller's Office for 8 years, and one of the initiatives we had done at one point was helping people reclaim funds that they did not know were owed to them. And in some of those instances, I cannot forget the look on their faces when they learned that they were getting even small amounts of money back that they never knew existed. It's such a rewarding feeling when you work in city government and in any type of government as a public servant and realize that you can make it a difference, that you can help other people.
Let me ask you this in a moment. I'm going to ask you the burning question we all have is you won a $10,000 reward, and how are you going to spend it? We will note that WBAI does accept tax-deductible contributions. Just kidding. But before that, I want to wonkishly talk to you just a little bit what you mentioned about Access NYC. And you're a public servant, so you're not allowed to express public political views, but I can say this. You know, I worked with a number of previous administrations, and there really was a sea change with the de Blasio administration and where the you know, Commissioner Banks, that there was really a full throttled dedication to using every resource to help low income people. And the greatest irony of the world is the better your agency does your job, their job, the less work you'll have, because the more clients, customers will have their benefits awarded properly. They'll be communicated with clearly from the agency why they got or were denied. And I do believe there's been a decline in fair hearings, and this is doing better at that. So can you talk a little bit more about Access NYC and what that is and how it's now available on a smartphone? I do a lot of work around the country, and the city is actually ahead of anywhere in the country in allowing people to access benefits using modern technology.
So with Access HRA, you can apply for SNAP benefits anywhere that you have internet connection, at your home, at the library. If you're a full-time employee, you don't have to take time off work to go into a center to receive benefits that you may be entitled to. We have a mobile app where you can upload documents that are necessary to make determinations on your case. It's just modern technology that really, really works well with the public. And I know my youngest daughter, she does not know a time where we didn't have mobile phones. So a lot of the, you know, population we serve have mobile phones. They have internet access, and they can, if they're at work and they can't take off, they're able to conduct their business at their leisure. They can call in for their interview between 8:30 and 5 o'clock, and they can just conduct their business from the comforts of their home. Or if we have, when we're serving our elderly population, if it's difficult for them to get to the location, they can have a representative that can conduct and assist them with their business.
Excellent. So I got to ask, do you know how you're going to spend the $10,000 award?
Well, my youngest daughter, she's graduating high school on June 25th. She's leaving on July 1st to go to college. So this is going to really, really help us get off to a good start.
Oh, excellent. And what advice would you have for someone seeking to enter public service and maybe work for the city? We only have about 30 seconds left, but what's your parting advice for someone else trying to serve the public?
That it is the most rewarding job that you can do. And although you may experience challenges throughout, at the end of the day, when you go home, and you're in the comforts of your own home, just knowing that you helped someone today is one of the greatest rewards.
Well, what a perfect way to end the show. Thank you so much, and congratulations, Sandy.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thanks again. Have a great day.
You too. Someone who really enjoys what they do and makes such a great impact, it's the dream of everybody to have a job like that. It's amazing.
And we love complaining about government, but she's working for us, and let's not forget that. The people who repair our parks, the people who protect our streets, the people who teach our children, people who deliver social service, they are working for us.
Yes, indeed. And with that, another edition of City Watch has come to a close. Thanks to you, Joel and Jeff, for pulling together an interesting and timely group of guests. Thanks also to engineer Sean Rhodes, another flawless performance on the boards. And thanks especially to you for listening and supporting the show. We simply cannot do any of this without your generosity. Remember, if you missed any part of the show or just want to listen in again, the MP3 download is available at WBAI.org. Click on Archives, then City Watch. The show should be up and ready online in about 10 minutes. It'll stay up for 90 days. That's it for us. Stay tuned for On the Count. Enjoy your weekend.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, What a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white. The bright, blessed day, the dark, sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Public media is under fire, but it cannot be bought. My name is Brake Edwards. I'm the host of the Artsy Fartsy Show, which airs on Tuesdays at 2 p.m. WBAI is listener-sponsored, commercial-free radio, reporting on news that we know matters to you. Instead of the headline-grabbing sensationalism, consider joining public media that tells the truth by making a tax-free donation to this station. You can donate by going right to our website, give2wbai.org, or pledge right from your smartphone by texting WBAI to 41444. Thank you so much for your support.
Hi, this is Chloe Glickman, and I'm an intern at WBAI. Looking to get professional experience doing something you're actually passionate about? At WBAI, I'm able to develop skills in journalism, marketing, event planning, editing, social networking, and much more, all while working directly with producers and the management team. BAI is always taking applications for credit and non-credit internships, so get in touch today. Send an email to internships@wbai.org for more information. Join the team that supplied New York with independent radio for over 50 years. Help keep community radio going strong.
There is nothing wrong with your radio. Do not attempt to switch the station. You are locked into our frequency at 99.5 on your FM dial. If we wish to make it louder, we can turn up the volume. If we wish to make it softer, we can tune it to a whisper. We can take the music and change it to fit all that we want you to hear throughout the course of this broadcast. We can take the music and change it from vintage psychedelia to soft, mystical reggae. We can transform a 60s classic and propel the song right into modern times. Come down off your throne. For the remainder of the program, sit quietly and we will control all that you hear. You will experience the awe and mystery that takes you from the depth of night and covers your entire body with morning dew. WBAI, New York.
High Praise with Dalton Anderson, the best in great praise and inspirational music every Sunday morning at 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can email me your song request to Dalton, D-A-U-L-T-O-N, at WBAI.org. High Praise with Dalton Anderson on Sunday morning, 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on WBAI 99.5 FM in New York.
Hello, my name is Harriet Cole. I have a program called Dream Leapers with Harriet Cole that airs every Sunday at 8 a.m. on WBAI 99.5 FM. Dream Leapers is an educational platform that I designed to help people access and activate their dreams. On this show, I will interview dynamic individuals, entrepreneurs, designers, actors, producers, directors, authors, and more, who will share their journey of how they manifested their dreams. The goal is for you to learn how to manifest your own. Tune in every Sunday at 8 a.m. on WBAI 99.5 or online at WBAI.org. Have a great day and make it count.
Hey, what's going on? This is Tito Nieves. I want you all to know that I listen to Con Sabor Latino, Montuneando con Marisol, alternating Sundays from 3 to 6 on WBAI 99.5 FM. or WBAI.org. Listen live. Also on archive when I miss the show. You know what I love about this show? They inform me about everything. Who recorded, who sang, who composed. And you know what? Shows like this, they're not around anymore. That's why they've been in existence for 34 years. And you know what? I like it like that all the time.